Hey, good morning, friends. Good morning. Welcome to the gathering. Hey, take just a quick second and turn to the folks sitting next to you and say, it's good to see you. It's good to see you. Good to see you. Good to see you. It's good to be seen. It's good to see you. Thank you for being here this morning. What a gift it is to be here together, to participate in this rhythm together in the midst of a hectic week, in the midst of a hectic semester. I know this is the time in the semester where things start to come due, tests start to come. Hope that you're finding ways to stay rested, to stay your best self, to be rejuvenated. I hope that this morning is an opportunity for you to have your spirit filled as we join in this space together, as we hear a word from God. And today, I'm really, really excited. I think we're in for such a treat today. Today is going to begin our exploration of the fruit of the Spirit. We've been leading up to this moment all semester long. And now, from now until kind of the end of the semester, we'll spend every week looking at one of the specific fruits of the Spirit that we believe makes up the holistic fruit of the Spirit. The type of characteristics and practices and dispositions that define people whose lives have been changed, whose lives have been altered by the love, the grace, the mercy of Jesus. And I'm really grateful. I'm super excited for that to start today. And we're going to start with one of those characteristics, one of those practices, one of those dispositions that is, in some ways, sort of at the root, at the foundation of it all, that everything falls under the gift, the practice of love. And here in a little while, we'll get to hear one of our friends from our community share about this gift of love, this disposition, this action of love. And I can't wait for you to hear from her and to hear from some of your other classmates today as well. Let me tell you where we're going for the rest of this morning here in just a moment. As always, you're going to hear from your SGA president, Grant Hitchcock, who will update you with a few things happening in our community. After that, Helena Kaptimer is going to come up and read some scripture for us. Garner Harsh will say our prayer this morning. And then our speaker this morning may be a familiar face to some of you. She is such a gift to our campus, to our community. If you have had the chance of participating with the theater department, then you know her well. Becki Baker, who is the chair of the Department of Theater, is here with us this morning. And like I said, is going to share some about this action, this gift that is cultivated inside of us through the power of the Spirit, this gift, this action of love. She's going to share with us for just a few moments. And then after that, I'll let her kind of lead into this, but we'll have a special performance from some of your classmates this morning. I'm so excited. We believe that each of you are incredibly gifted, incredibly talented. And any chance that we get to feature those gifts and talents for the good of our community, we love taking those opportunities. So I'm grateful for your classmates saying yes and spending some time preparing something that I think is going to bless you this morning. Before I hand it off to Grant, I want to make one special announcement. One of the gifts of being part of this community is that you get the opportunity to participate in missional work in our city, in our country, and in our world. And the Lipscomb Missions Department is hosting a missions fair tonight in the Student Center from 5 to 7 p.m. where you can meet team leaders and learn about opportunities to join God's mission here in Nashville and around the world. So it doesn't matter if you, it doesn't matter what your interests are. It doesn't matter what your major is. If you are a student or even if you're a faculty or a staff member here with us this morning, you are welcome to attend that missions fair tonight in the Student Center from 5 to 7 p.m. And we've got a short video just to tell you a little bit more about Lipscomb Missions.
At Lipscomb, we believe that what we learn in the classroom can change the world. Lipscomb Missions provides ways for our students to explore how their chosen vocations can express the kingdom of God in our own communities and across the globe. Our teams go to 25 countries and 7 states, including Tennessee, to serve and learn from local communities, partnering with ministries who work there year-round. Because we connect with the same partner ministries each year, we're able to deepen our relationships with them and grow together over time, ensuring that every short-term trip can have a long-lasting impact. Our teams are made up of current and future professionals in their field, including engineering, business, education, medicine, social work, ministry, and more, all using their skills to pursue God's mission. Join a mission team today and experience what it means to live God-formed lives of mission.
Good morning. So to start off, sophomore week was a success. Thank you to President McQueen and to Student Life for helping make that happen. And thank you to the sophomores for showing up and for making the most out of the week. And some exciting news that I'm sure most of you have not heard. Some of you have, I'm sure. But SGA has changed a little bit this year. And instead of doing committees, we are doing classes instead. And the goal behind this is to be more intentional with the people that elected us into these roles. And one of the things that we're doing is hosting class-specific events throughout the semester. So sophomore week was last week. There will be another sophomore event at some point this semester. And each class, look out for your own event as well. We have a busy weekend with athletics. This weekend we have volleyball games, soccer games, and softball games. So be sure and go out and support your friends and our athletic teams this weekend. For the first human docs of the year, it will be Los Hermanos, and that will be Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. in Chamblin. And then one more thing about SGA is that the executive office hours were posted this week, and have you heard? And if you need anything, or if you'd just like to swing by, you're more than welcome to. Thank you.
Today I'll be reading 1 John 4, verses 7 through 12 and 16 through 18. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world, and that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives us out of fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather in this time of fellowship, I want to thank you for each individual seated in this room who have been uniquely created in your perfect image. I pray that they know how valued and loved they are, not only by this university, but by you, Father. Let us be instruments of change in your kingdom, using our unique gifts and talents to serve your people. Father, I pray for a spiritual revival, restoration, and a renewed focus on you. May that revival begin in our hearts and spirit right now. May our community be known for love. Let us emulate your light in everything we do, whether that be in the classroom, on the playing field, in a rehearsal, or in any moment in our daily lives. Father, I thank you for Professor Baker. Thank you for her heart and her faith in you. Let her speak truth and wisdom over the student body, and let us have open heart to accept her teachings and apply them to our lives. Help us be present in your word, to make a daily choice to walk in faith, and to be anchored in your truth. We ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hello. Hi, everyone. I'm Becki Baker. As they said, I'm the chair of the theater department here, and I'm so grateful for you having me today. Now, I have the incredible task to speak about love. How does one even begin? It's only the central reality of the universe. God is love. There, did I cover it? Good? I mean, poets, artists, musicians, philosophers, and theologians have tried to unpack what love is for centuries. So it must be pretty simple and straightforward, right? Yeah. Why couldn't I have whatever low-hanging fruit Dr. Lee Camp is probably going to talk about? Just kidding. We know it will be brilliant. Now, I could try to speak about love as a mother, as a wife, a daughter, a sister. I could try to speak about love as a woman or as a professor, but since they invited me specifically today, maybe I'll try talking about it as a theater artist. I've often appreciated William Shakespeare's description of love in Romeo and Juliet. In the famous balcony scene, Juliet declares to Romeo, "My bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite." Infinite. Infinite. Do you have infinite love? I will be honest, my love feels rather finite these days. The world is on fire, the pandemic rages on, and to be honest, I have been in quarantine with my three young children a little too long some days. Oh, Juliet, you sweet summer child. You tried to describe it, but that can't be right. Don't worry, Taylor Swift will spin your story into a fairy tale love song in a few hundred years. You'll be fine. All jokes aside, I have never felt more finite in my life than I do today. Without flinching, I can say that this has been the toughest year of my life. Exactly 1 year ago this week, about 7 months deep into the pandemic, I was diagnosed with stage 2 cancer. The diagnosis came out of nowhere and led to some of my darkest days. I had 2 successful surgeries last November, and on the day I was to hear from my oncologist if I needed chemotherapy, which absolutely terrified me, I received a call from my dean that my former student turned colleague and friend, Haley Sue Pearson, who some of you might know, had died in a tragic accident the night before. I was bereft. An hour later, I received my oncologist's phone call. I didn't need chemotherapy. I was considered cancer-free. So on December 7th, 2020, I received the worst and best phone calls of my life within an hour from each other. It's been a real roller coaster. It's been exhausting. But I'm grateful to God for my prognosis. I'm thankful to my friends, family, and Lipscomb community for their support during my journey. I deeply mourn my friend, and I continue on in the daily life of home and work. But my story isn't the only hard story in this room. I venture that many of you could claim the last year to year and a half as a very challenging time. There is thick personal and collective grief in the air. So how can we love well when we can barely keep up? As the scripture said, "Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. If we love one another, God lives in us and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us because he has given us of his spirit." So love is not merely an emotion, as Juliet tried to capture it, but an act of self-sacrifice modeled for us by God, who formed us out of love. So therefore, any love, compassion, mercy, justice that we are able to express, both to friends and strangers, beyond our limited abilities, must be the evidence of his spirit at work in us. So maybe the real question is, how do we increase the Spirit's capacity in us? There is no need to invite the Spirit here. It's already here. To quote Rod Whitaker, "God is more present in the room than we are." There are the traditional ways to open ourselves to God's presence, including the reading of God's word, worship, prayer, all of which matter. But I want to add another idea, which I hope encourages you. Tish Harrison Warren, in Liturgy of the Ordinary, writes that our spiritual efforts do not have to be solely relegated to those formal ways. It's in the dailiness of the Christian faith, she says, the making of the bed, the doing the dishes, the praying for your enemies, the reading the Bible, the quiet, the small, that God's transformation takes root and grows. If this is true, then no parts of our day are truly secular. Every moment, even the most mundane, is sacred because it's God's. I don't know about you, but I find that a relief. Everything we do can unfurl from our identity as the beloved, not by striving, not by perfection, but rather by the recognition that we have limited capacity and that the true work is leaning into God and letting His love move through us. As Warren writes, our task is not to somehow inject God into our work, but to join God in the work that He's already doing. Because He actually is boundless as the sea. He actually is infinite in His capacity for love. What Juliet imagined poetically, God is naturally. And oh, we will fail. How many times we will fail to love well. We will try to do it on our own, and we will come up short. Yet our stories are still being written, and God, through the Spirit, can show us a still better way. I've invited some of my theater students to share a song from Dear Evan Hansen with you today. Well, okay, they like that. You don't need to know the context of the show. This occasion is really about the words from the song. The Bible is clear. If you seek the Lord, even in the ordinary, you will be found. You will experience extraordinary love, and you will be able to offer that to others. As the students come up, I hope that you will listen to their song and that it will really speak to you today. Aw, you got some love. After the song ends, there will be a benediction from Darren Smith, so please hang around for that, but please be blessed.
Thank you, Becki, and thank you, theater students. Give it up for them one more time. Just how beautiful. All of you today gave us a powerful and moving reminder of the love of God. Praise be to the God who pursues us and finds us and makes all things new. God loves you, and God loves to find you. Becki said at the end of her message today, we will fail to love well. We will try to do it on our own, and we will come up short, yet our stories are still being written, and God, through the Spirit, can show us a still better way. Well said, Becki. Thank you. We are a community. All of us loved by God and created to love God and created to love each other. Therefore, may our God teach us how to love well. May the Spirit teach us that love is the most excellent way. May the story God writes in the Lipscomb community be a story of divine love received and of divine love released. May our good Father give us His heart for one another. May we see each other the way the Creator sees us as human beings created in God's image to represent his character to the world. In a world of hatred and condemnation, may we see the cross of Christ with clarity, that God demonstrates his love for us through self-sacrifice, that we, while we were still sinners and ungodly enemies of God, may be rescued and reconciled and found through the death and resurrection of God's Son, Jesus. May the Holy Spirit empower the Lipscomb community to give love away to each other as freely and as generously as we have received it from God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And now, go in the love of the Father, the grace of the Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit to join in the work of Christ in the world God loves, and to live the flourishing life you are created for. Amen.